Why do we never get an answer when we're knocking at the door with a thousand million questions about hate and death?
Hello. Welcome to TSC Talks, the podcast where we talk about tuberous sclerosis complex. My name is Jill Woodworth, and I'm your host. We're on episode 17 today. Welcome. We're actually not talking specifically about tuberous sclerosis complex today, but we're going to talk about special education. I thought I'd have a guest on who has a lot of experience locally with a daughter with special needs, as well as a typical daughter, and the process that she went through to advocate for her daughter over the years, the processes, as well as serving on the school committee. So she brings a perspective from both sides, representing the special needs parent, as well as the concerns of the community and budget concerns. I thought she gave a lot of advice as far as prepping for IEPs, dealing with placement issues, as well as the knowledge of the finances behind funding special ed in the district. There's just a lot of information. I learned a ton, and she prepared a beautiful document, which I'm going to post on the TSC Talks Facebook page, which goes into detail on the questions that I asked her for your reference. So please take advantage of that. And I'm going to share this in the local Wachusett Special Needs Parents Facebook group, and hoping to maybe branch off from this to do some more local work with an ancillary podcast. So, without further ado, I'd like to welcome Stacey Jackson, mother of two. She's an engineer. She's been on the school committee for 9 years, and she's an amazing advocate for her daughter, Megan. Thanks so much, Stacey, for being on, and take it away.
Stacey, can you welcome to the podcast?
Thank you. I'm so excited to join you.
Yes, I know. We've kind of gone back and forth for a while, getting these questions together, and I really appreciate your support in this. And I think you have great information to share. So why don't we kick it off, and you can tell me a little bit about your life so far, your background, how you came to be where you are now.
Okay. Well, I've been in Holden for about 20 years. My husband and I have basically moved to Holden right after we got married about 20 years ago. I had been working full-time as an engineer when I had Meg, my oldest, who is now almost 17. And
wow.
Very early on, we learned that she had some special needs. She wasn't making those baby milestones, sitting up on time and crawling and walking. So we got early intervention involved when she was about 15 months old, started taking her to every specialist and doctor in central Massachusetts to figure out what was going on. And
yeah.
And it was hard at that time because all we got was global developmental delays. And like the couple of you in the special ed community had an actual diagnosis. They could Google it. They could look it up. They could connect with other families. And for us, we had this general term that really didn't mean anything. We knew, very few people in the special ed community, and it was hard.
It was
isolating and, really hard to dig into it. So, we got early intervention involved, and that was good just to have that connection of someone who knew about this world.
Right.
And yeah.
Having them come to the house was always such a social piece too when I was in the, had kids in early intervention. So I can relate.
Yeah. And I think I got more out of it than Megan did, because I was just craving, that connection to other families that got it. And
yes.
And
am I normal or am I going to lose it? Yeah. That kind of thing.
Right. Yeah. And at that time, I realized pretty early on, like working full time with, what Megan needed really was not going to work for our family.
Yeah.
So I gave up engineering for a bit and tried teaching, thinking, I would have similar schedule as the, we knew we wanted other children as well.
Mm-hmm.
Did that for a year, and that really wasn't a great fit either. So at that point, my original company came to me and said, hey, would you be interested in working part-time from home? And that has been the perfect solution to our family.
That's
because,
great.
Even now, I've picked up a lot more hours now. I go into the office one day a week, but it's super flexible and it's allowed me to be able to do so much for Meg. And one of the most important things I've been able to do, especially when she was in the elementary school, is volunteer at the school. And that was just so critical to make those connections with the teachers and with the staff. I mean, yes, you have IEP meetings every year, but it was so important, just those hallway conversations at the photocopier, or, you know, going to a PTA meeting and having a conversation with the sped teacher about what math curriculum works best.
That's really brave too, because when you have a kid, not to cut you off, but I have to just say this really quick, when you have a kid with special needs, stepping in and volunteering can be intimidating. So.
Yes. Yep. Yeah. But I think it was just so important not only to be there for those conversations, but to also establish myself as a very involved parent, as a parent who, you know, is going to be there and do the hard work, and also to support the teachers, because, you know, one of the most important things is give praise where praise is due and help out where you can. You know, I think a lot of times some special ed parents get a bad rap of, oh, you know, those parents are never happy with anything. Well, if you are happy, you need to express that. And also,
absolutely,
you know, there's a lot of folks that are working so hard for our kids. So if, you know, if there's something that we can do to give back, it's so helpful. But like I said, just having those hallway conversations were just so critical to us early on. So,
yeah,
you know, back to Meg's development, we did EI until she was three, got into the early child care program, had, you know, great services. You know, we really, things went really well then. Megan had a one-to-one paraprofessional starting when she was three. And we've found that it's been so instrumental to have a really good para, to have that support and have someone who
gets
your kids.
That's another podcast.
Yeah, we could do a whole podcast on
I know.
That.
Oh, my goodness. I didn't even think of that until you brought
Yeah, but having good paras, you know, is just so critical. And coming out of ECC, Meg had a lot of challenges, you know, socially, fine motor, gross motor, academically, that the district recommended she go into one of our developmental classrooms in our district. And that's a program for kids typically with communication and or cognitive disorders. And, you know, I had looked at her and I thought about, you know, my friends that had typical kindergartners and said, she's not there. She needs something different. She's not going to be able to sit still for several hours and follow along. So we did put her in the developmental classroom. And I think it was the right decision at the right time. But then after a while, we didn't see the progress that we thought she was capable of. The other big challenge, with our district, one of the good things about our district and one of the bad things about the district is the size of it. And because it's a five-town district, not each town can support these specialized programs. So we ended up sending Meg to a school in Sterling where the program was. And that was a really hard decision because here was a kid that is challenged socially as well as other things. But now we're putting her in a school where she knew nobody and we knew nobody.
Oh, yes. I can so relate.
So that was really hard. You know, these weren't kids that we would see on the playground or we would run into at the grocery store or the library. You know, they weren't our network. I remember one time my mother was babysitting while I went to the school's curriculum night. My mother said, oh, why don't you go out for coffee with the other moms afterwards? And I was in tears going, I don't know anybody in the whole school.
Yeah, it's really isolating and it affects the whole family when your kid's sent to an out of the hometown or their you know, natural setting.
Yeah.
It's really challenging.
So that was really hard, especially, you know, like I said, for a kid that has social challenges to begin with.
Yes.
So, you know, there were no birthday party invitations. There were no play dates because also I didn't know these people and they didn't know me. So that was really hard. So after 2 years there, we really said, you know what? Let's try inclusion. Let's, you know, I felt like she had made some progress and I felt like she was able to attend in a regular class a lot better. So, you know, we approached the district and said, hey, you know, can we get her in her neighborhood school? And the district, I mean, the professionals did their job. They need to advocate for what they truly feel is the best.
Right.
And they truly felt that was the best placement for her. And we did not. And, you know, I understood where they were coming from. They understood where we were coming from, but we were at an impasse. So we ended up going to mediation and advocating for the local school as well as retaining her. We did that at the same time as well, thinking, you know, she's already had the academics of first grade, but she hasn't had the social aspect of being in a regular ed classroom.
So you retained her,
So we retained her as part of that big move. And, you know, we easily sold it to her. She was in first grade at the time. And we said, well, you did first grade in this other school, but you haven't done first grade in your local school. So you got to do it again. Okay, that's fine.
Whatever works.
Yeah. And I know a lot of families always struggle with going to mediation and, oh, my God, that's a big step. Do I need an attorney? Do I need an advocate? It's overwhelming. Honestly, I had to say it was the best experience for us because we sat in a room and we felt so strongly that this was where she needed to be. And the mediator came in, and this was such an empowering moment for me because the mediator walked in and she said, okay, on one side of the table, we have all the school staff and they have their degrees and their expertise and their education. And on the other side, we have the parents. And they have their knowledge of their child and their gut.
I love that.
And at my table, both are equally important. And I just wanted to get up and hug her.
That like makes me tear up because that's the essential issue is we all have our areas where we know this kid and how do we bring it to the best possible solution for everybody.
Right. And I actually ran into her at a conference about 2 years later. And I said to her, like, that was such a powerful statement for me. And that's something that, that I've always come back to in every meeting that I've gone to with Meg is that I am an equal part of this team. And not everyone in the room might feel that way, but that was just so empowering for me as a parent to know that my expertise of my kid, you know, I spend so much more time with her than anyone in this room. And my expertise is important and it does have merit and it does have weight. And that was just so helpful. So, So Meg went off to the local elementary school, had great support. And, you know, it was just, it was so important for the teachers there, I think, to see that they could do a great job with a kid with significant special needs. And I think it was a challenge in our district because most children with Meg's profile are not in general ed. So it caused everyone to kind of rise up and step up their game. And everyone rose to the occasion, the teachers, the support staff, Meg, you know, it was just, it was a great thing. And I think it also really helped the peers as well. And while she was there, we started working with the classrooms on disability awareness because, you know, the kids obviously knew there was something different about
Meg.
Right.
I remember that program. Did you start that at Davis Hill?
It started at Glenwood School.
Okay.
And then we started taking it to other district schools because it was just so important to educate the peers as to what's going on with these kiddos and why do they act the way they do and what makes them behave a certain way or ask certain questions. And like anything with, you know, once you explain something, they can understand it better and they can embrace
it. And it's not scary.
Exactly.
Yeah. I think there's a lot of fear.
Right. Yeah. You're not going to catch autism from someone if you play with them, things like that.
Right. Right.
So, you know, it was a great, great experience there. And then she was getting ready for middle school. And once again, the district said, oh, we really think you need to look at the developmental classroom again. And we did. We went and looked at it. And we thought it was a good program. And yes, it would have been a good fit for Meg. But socially, she wouldn't be around all these kids that she had spent all of elementary school with. And academically, we said, yes, it's a great program. Yes, they're doing great things to modify the curriculum, but why can't every school do that? Why does it have to be in a different town with kids that we're not used to? So we said, you know, again, let's try regular you know, the local school. Mm-hmm. And if it doesn't work, we can always go back. There's always a plan.